I've been counting by six, learning my facts by memory, to multiply by memory. Six times one is six, six times two equals 12, six times three is 18, six times four is 24, can't you tell? Six times five is 30, six times six, 36, six times seven is 42, gotta know it so don't forget. Oh, 6, 12, 18, 24, 30 and 36, 42, 48, 54, 60, 66, 72. Am I surprising you? Counting by six all the way through. Counting by six all the way through. I've been counting by six, learning my facts by memory, to multiply by memory. Now six times eight, you know that's 48. And six times nine is 36, the digits add to nine isn't that great. Six times 10 is 60, times 11 is 66. Six times 12 is 72, you gotta say it so it sticks.
Welcome to Thursday, April 16th. I'm hoping you're getting used to our format. You're subscribing to my channel. I know we joke about it on Zoom, but we're up to about four people. So, I mean, I need to beat David Z by next week with 11. If I have to make fake accounts, I guess that's where we're going to go with this. But I hope you subscribe and just get ready for more content. It's going to be 6 weeks of pure golden Miss Princell YouTube content, guys. That being said, today we are doing something that I'm hoping will be a little bit of a break for you in math, because we went over this plenty and you guys really were successful the first time we did this. So I'm hoping it's your kind of Thursday easy break, but we're doing prime and composite numbers today. You have a Thursday problem solver. So I've been talking all week about that word problem with Samuel's pencils. We finished that up and we're moving on now for you to work on a kind of part A, part B type problem. So today is going to be part A and then part B would be the next day. And I will show you what that looks like and what that means. Then, of course, we're going to go over your achieve, and today is the day that you're supposed to be doing that activity. So I'm actually going to go through question one and question two with you and hope that it gets you a little boost and it gets you moving and remembering that kind of work that we do at the small group table in the morning when you need help, those walkthroughs of annotating and then kind of process of elimination. I want to kind of refresh your guys' brains using the one that's going to be in that packet or the PDF that's sent. So of course, if you're doing it online, I know you're going to go, well, my questions are different, but it is on the same article. So I'm hoping that it will help you and just kind of refresh your brain on that. Epic NAR is, of course, always on the chart for 30 minutes, and then we'll finish up with going over that power writing day four prompt.
Stay at home, that's the governor's order. Might last week, so I hope that it's shorter. But for now, can I have your attention? Yeah, these are my only intentions. Get some rest, take some time to be grateful. Use your mind, keep reading and be playful.
Okay, so for math, we're going to start out, and I told you prime and composite. If you see, there's about, what, four problems, and you're going to choose if it's prime or composite, and then tell me why. So justify your answer, not just say one or the other. You, of course, can access on Google Classroom, and of course, you have that access to a form that I made for you if you are not using Google Classroom. And then that taking out a fresh sheet of paper is always an option that I love to see you guys doing. Okay, our learning intention for today is that, of course, it's always worded I am learning, but we are actually learning and / reviewing whether a given number in the range of 1 to 100, so we're just going up to 100, is prime or composite. In fourth grade, you do not need to be able to find if it's prime or composite beyond 100 is the standard. So, I thought it was very fitting when I typed in remember this song and there was me bent over kind of shaking a little. I know some of you that is your faces when this song played the first time. The only good thing about today and being virtual is that technically you guys have the power to just go through, but I really think you know how I feel about humor and funny songs, and I couldn't do this concept and not bring this guy back. So I'm going to hit play, and then we'll be on our way to review some vocabulary like we would in class. Oh, that was so sad. There we go.
It's a number greater than one. Divisors, it's got none. The only number that goes into it is one. If I think hard, I think I could name some. I will try until I got it. These numbers are prime and not composite. A lot of people might not know, but I think I'll give it a go. This is my prime song. I sing it all the time song. Gotta give it a try song. So many numbers, one than another. I sing my prime song. And I don't really care if nobody else will hear, 'cause I've still got a lot of prime numbers here. The prime numbers start with 2 and 3, 5, 7, 11, and 13, 17, then 19, 23, and 31, 37, then 41, then we see 43, 47, 53, how many more can there be? 59 and 61, 67 and 71, this is my prime song. I sing it all the time song, gotta give it a try song. So many numbers, one than another. I'll sing my prime song, and I don't really care if nobody else will hear, 'cause I've still got a lot of prime numbers here. I've still got a lot of prime numbers here. '73, '79, '83, '89, '97, '101. I knew I could name some. I knew I could name some. This is my prime song. I sing it all the time song. Gotta give it a try song. So many numbers, one than another. I sing my prime song, and I don't really care if nobody else will hear. I said I don't really care if nobody else will hear, 'cause I've still got a lot of prime numbers here.
All right, back to my voice. I want to review our vocabulary just like we do in class, guys. I want to make sure that we're kind of sticking to that same routine because honestly, it was working for you guys. So stick with me. I know it might be repetitive, but just stick with me during this and then we'll move on to get some practice in. So our first vocab word is composite numbers, and it means that it is a positive integer having three or more whole number factors. That is a lot of vocab words within a vocab word. So that is why I'm going to break it down for you. If you look at that chart, and it was the one that was right on the wall the entire lesson when we had this and the module, your composite numbers are going to have, the main idea is three or more whole number factors. Why whole numbers? Because we don't want to start playing that game with decimals or fractions, because you guys are way, way, way advanced in that sense and start kind of playing around with those, and you don't want to go there. That's not the definition of a composite number. It needs to be a whole number that has factors of three or more. And what that means in the context of a prime number, which you'll see there's many more composite than prime, a positive integer greater than one having whole number factors of only one and itself. If you remember that prime word I always told you, prime is one and me. It's self, I, and me. You just have one and itself. So two is one and two. Two times one, three times one, five times one, seven times one. It's only itself times one will get you that number. That's the only possible way to get it. Okay. Now, I want to make sure I brought back this word because if you looked in both those definitions, you are going to be finding the word factors. And that's why we did the factors and multiples the day before. And I want you to remember this was our review that we did with multiples and factors, but it's going to apply and build for today. A factor is a number that you multiply together to get a product. So you want to make sure that you understand that factors are still in that same definition. We are now just using that knowledge, carrying it over into this concept. All right, so right here, I want to make sure we're together and we're seeing this side by side. A prime number only has two, blank, one, and itself. What is that missing word? I feel like Dora the Explorer waiting for your guys' response that I know isn't coming because it's virtual. But the hope is that you would have said factors. A prime number only has two factors, one in itself. Prime factors only have one factor pair. Remember, we did factor pairs yesterday. There's a reason we did those first. A factor pair is like a pair of socks. You have two factors. Two times one is a factor pair. And a prime number only has one factor pair. One and itself. Now a composite number. A composite number has three or more blank. And what's going to go in that blank? Factors. A composite number has three or more factors. Composite numbers have more than one factor pair. So they have multiple factor pairs. And think back to yesterday, we did numbers that had multiple factors and multiple factor pairs. You would go back and go, oh, 24, that had four factor pairs. That number's composite. Those type of ideas still apply. And you could go back to that page, guys, and start going prime, composite. That's an exercise that would be amazing for you guys to think back on now that you did that work yesterday with factor pairs. That being said, we're going to go and practice right now. So I brought over these vocab cards because I want you to go into your memory files. I want you to bring out that stuff. This isn't just supposed to be that you have to memorize all these things. You want to apply your knowledge to when we practice. So it says, note, first list all the factors for a number, then determine whether it is prime or composite based on the number of factors. So what they're asking you to do is not to sit there and just hope you're right. They're asking you to go, okay, yes, I know five is. Say if you look up at that chart, you'll be able to go, oh, five is highlighted for prime. But the most important part of this is how do you know? That's always the most important part. It's not just that we get the right answer, it's knowing how. So for five, we can say, yeah, sure, it's prime. Of course, Ms. Princell, you gave us the answer. It's right up there in your memory files. No, but how do you know? How you would know is you would say, it only has two factors, one times five. And what I don't want you to get confused in, just like I did when we were in class, two factors, think of socks. If you have two socks, you only have one factor pair. A pair requires two. So that is a play on words that you don't want to get caught in. Yes, two factors, but two factors make one pair. And that is what is needed. Only one factor pair for prime. So yes, it is prime. We have confirmed that. Now let's move on to 11. Is it prime or composite? So they kind of shorten that to P and C. Don't be confused. If you want to write out prime or composite to be clear, that's completely fine. Prime or composite, you say fine. It's prime. It's up here. You have that knowledge. But now over here, you're going to say, how would you know? You know that because it only has two factors, and that is one and itself. One times 11 is the only thing with whole numbers that I can multiply to get there. Now our next one is 15. If you want to think, which I would love before you come up here, is that you would go, oh, 15 times one is always going to work. But what about five? I know 5, 10, 15. So I have two ways to get to 15 with factor pairs. So now I'm going to say I have more than two factors. I have 1, 3, 5, and 15. And that's why yesterday we listed our factors in this kind of number order, because I wanted you guys to get used to this idea that you're knowledgeable enough to know that 1 times 15 is that first factor pair, and 3 times 5 is going to get us 15, and that's our second factor pair. So we have more than two factors, and it is confirmed that it is composite. Now our last one is 16. A trick you can always use is, like, if it's an even number and you know that 2 can go into 16, you're pretty confirmed that you're going to go with a composite number, because you're at least going to have more than two factors, because you're always going to have 16 times 1 itself times 1, and you know 2 goes into it. So you're already going, okay, I'm out of the woods with prime. I know it's composite. But now our job is to say how and all the ways we know that this will work. This one is more than two factors, and you have 1 times 16, that equals 16. 2 times 8, but then wait, why do we just have 4? 4 times 2, no, that's 8. 4 times 8, that's 32. 4 times 4 is 16. But do you have to list 4 twice? No, that wouldn't make sense. You're not going to keep listing. You don't say 1, 1, 2, 2. No, you list 4 and you're knowledgeable enough to go, oh yeah, 4 is a factor, but it's 4 times 4. That's why it's still, I have 3 factor pairs, even though I just have a 4 listed here. I know 4 times 4 is what I'm missing there with 16. All right. So for that, you're just going to want to log back in and kind of finish up that work. I always like to take you back, though, to that page to make sure we're all on the same page as far as then what is expected now that you need to go get your work done. So what you're going to do is you're going to go in and you're going to tell whether the number is prime or composite, and then explain how you know, just as we just practiced. I built the Google form just today, kind of knowing what's been a struggle in the past ones with entering and answers. So I split it up, and if you look right here, it has the prime and composite just on the page. You're going to put your name in, that's required, and then down here you're going to start. So the 5 is prime or composite, you're going to click prime or composite, and then just as we just did, you're going to come down here and explain why you selected it. So you're going to have to tell me it is prime because, and you can say it has two factors, just like they did in the video right now, or you can say it has more than two and you want to list those factors. So I really did that in the video with you in that same format, because I'm hoping if you get stuck and you don't really know what needs to go in here, you can go back to that video, play it, and see. So it will go down, you do 27, 32, and 71, all the same type of way, and then press submit at the end in their own kind of cluster in the back. That being said, what you are doing online, you'll just click in and it will be just this Thursday problem. And down here for the forum, same thing, just the Thursday problem. I want to read it aloud to you and kind of discuss kind of a launching point for you and really give you a chance to explore it on your own. As I said, it's part A, part B. So you're just doing part A for Thursday. Tomorrow you'll do part B. The problem reads, the Parkinson's family was working to fill their pool for the summer. After Monday, it was already 3/12 full. On Tuesday, it filled another 4/12. How much more in a fraction did the pool need to be filled before it was filled completely? For myself, I know the second I heard the word pool, I immediately thought, oh, I want to draw a square, a circle, some object, some model that I can start modeling this with. I imagine myself taking out some crayons or some markers and going first for that. After Monday, it was 3/12. And I picture creating, let me go back, creating kind of this circle right here that I'm going to, the circle that I'm going to have right here, I'm going to mark it down and I'm going to slash it through and have 3/12 and color it in. And then I want to add the 4/12 into that same model because it's the same pool. We don't have two separate pools. It's one pool that we're filling. And then I really need to step back from that model and go, wait, what's my question? And the question you want to remind yourself is, how much more in a fraction did the pool need to be filled before it was filled completely? So you're not necessarily wanting to go quick with this one and just add numbers and move on. you really want to take your time and think, what am I looking for? And if you do it like that, with that lens on, then I know you guys will be successful with this. More importantly, tomorrow on Zoom, I'll be going over it and then releasing in the next video the answer, or I don't like really saying answer, but kind of the model that was the way you wanted to go with it, so that you can then be ready for part B if part A was a
all
challenge.
All the while, avoid the blues. Kids, can anybody erase your own place in my heart? We're a strong family, even though we're apart. Memories we'll never lose. Classroom or not, that's the truth. Stay at home, that's the governor's order. Might last weeks, though I hope that it's shorter. But for now, can I have your attention? Yeah, these are my only intentions. Get some rest, take some time to be grateful. Use your mind, keep reading and be playful. Get creative, design an invention. Yeah, these are my only intentions.
All right, so then I did mention something I switched up a little bit today, because it is supposed to be your day to do your activity. And in the past, I've just kind of given it to you, but I was really trying to reflect and think on what were my practices in class and the support that I give you. And I know that those 30 minutes in the morning, I have multiple questions and multiple opportunities for you guys to come up and get help with certain questions. So I wanted to kind of pitch doing the first two questions, and I wanted to get some feedback from you guys and see if it was overkill, meaning it just wasn't really necessary, or if you guys would appreciate me kind of grouping these activities, maybe even just going over one of the articles each week, because I know we have two, and just going deeper into it and walking you through the thought process that you should be going through as a reader. So I'm going to do the first two, as I said, and then I'm kind of going to talk to some of you guys on Zoom, and I know not all of you make it there. I would love dojos or emails and saying like, yeah, that was helpful, or Miss Princell, I zip forward your 10 minutes and did my achieve activity online. Either one is helpful, no matter if you think you're hurting my feelings. Truly, I'm just trying to be there for you guys in this time. All right, so the first question says, since and then, and it says, based on the article, which fits best in the empty box above? So what I want you guys to remember, just because, you know, we're in this format and you're not hearing my voice and my reminders, you need to annotate your question. There is absolutely no reason you should have any question paper, anything, especially with Achieve, that is not annotated. You know, I would just look at you and have you retry and make sure you're really getting that question down. So that being said, you want to give yourself that yellow light and annotate the question, even if you think you have it in the bag, meaning even if you think you got it all right, there is no harm, absolutely no harm in the practice. So if you go in and annotate, all you would want to make sure you're pulling out is that you know it's based on the article. So you are going to be looking for this answer and knowing your answer is coming straight from the article we read yesterday. Which fits best? That is the magical Achieve word, and often a word on your test. Fits best is that sign that you need to go, I need to be super alert today, because it's not just one that fits. It is not just one that sounds right. There are going to be multiple that sound right, and I have the job to figure out which one is best. They are trusting you with that ability. You got to take that on and own it. And then the last one is empty box above. I underlined that because I really wanted you guys to go, this is your hint. This is your hint of Miss Princell saying, put it in the box and then reread it. That is what you need to do. So that being said, down we go. It says, some students, and I put an arrow there because I wanted you guys to really visually see this. Some students didn't take part in Michael Scollin's study. Then he gave students extra credit if they took part in a sleep study before a test. Huh? You should immediately go, they didn't take part. Since they didn't take part in the study, then he gave students extra credit if they took part, but it already said they didn't take part. So that's not going to lead to the next one, because it's talking about the kids who didn't take part in it. He's talking about the kids who did. It's not even on the same topic or main idea. You need to get that one out of there. You're lost. It's confusing. There's a reason you're lost. X that guy out. A is out. You go to the next. Michael Scolin wanted his students to get more sleep. Then he gave students extra credit if they took part in a sleep study before a test. Since he wanted his students to get more sleep, then he gave them extra credit if they took part in it. Makes sense. I'm sitting there eating my apple saying, yep, that makes sense. He wanted them to get more sleep, so he went, how am I going to get them to get more sleep? I know how. I'm going to give them extra credit if they do it before a test. That sounds like a good deal to me. I'm going to leave that one in there, and I am not going to press B and hit next. Why? Because I still have C and D, and that magical line underneath says fits best. You have to remember, you have the duty to find the best fit, not just the one that makes sense. So you need to ride this question through all the way till the end. On to C. Michael Scolin's students had no trouble paying attention. He gave students extra credit if they took part in a sleep study before a test. Say, huh? That one makes zero sense. You're okay with B. C, Michael Scolin's students had no trouble paying attention. He gave students extra credit if they took part in a sleep study. He is talking about students having no trouble paying attention, and then he moves over to a sleep study. What is paying attention? Sleep, like, what? They are not in direct impact. Are both in the article? Sure, yes, they're both in the article, but they are not a direct impact. It is not a sense of them. The one I tell you all the time, and it probably annoys you, the one where I tell you there's water in the glass, and Miss Princell knocks it over. Since there's water in the glass and she hit it, then there's water on the floor. Because students did not have trouble paying attention, the result of that, the then, is not that they took part in a sleep study before a test. If they had no trouble paying attention, he wouldn't want to do a sleep study to get him to pay more attention and get more sleep. It just, those two do not make any logical sense. Now, D, some students had Michael Scolin as a professor. I just X'd that guy out way too quick. And my reasoning is that is the one that I've been warning us all, and you all have been so good at, especially with benchmark, knowing the ones that are details that just don't apply. Just because people have him as a professor does not mean that caused him to give out extra credit for a sleep study. That does not say anything. Is that a true fact? Of course, there are kids who have him as a professor, but that has nothing to do with this sense. And then as a reader, thinking hard and integrating your knowledge and analyzing this article. Out that goes, and you're left with B. B is your best answer. Moving on to question two. It says, let's say you are writing a summary of the article, which is most important to put in the summary. Again, Ms. Princell in the yellow light is there, and she's telling you to annotate your question. I have underlined the word summary because that is your key skill. That is what you are required to be using to be able to understand and answer this question. You also need to be knowledgeable about most important. Again, they are doing that to you, and I know it's not nice, but it's the reality of the question. They are telling you there's multiple things that need to go in this summary, but you are looking for the one that is most important. So be ready. Be ready for multiple answers to sound okay. You need to be ready then to pull out the one that's most important. All right, let's start with A. A professor did a sleep experiment to show students that getting enough sleep matters. Yeah, that's the article. The article we read yesterday was on a professor that noticed his students weren't getting enough sleep. They should be getting 7 to 9 hours, as I told you, Ms. Princell, it says I should. You guys should be 10 to 13. And he decided to put a little band on them and see, and if they slept more, how they would do on the test. The people who actually went through with it and slept more, he not only found out they did better on their test, but that they got some extra credit for it. So yes, a sleep experiment happened. Sleep matters was the topic, and there was a professor. Okay, I'm good with that, but I am not going to sell myself to A and say that's my answer. I have B, C, and D. So B says, some students at Baylor University in Texas only get 5 hours of sleep each night. Is that going to be the most important thing in my summary? No, because it's definitely not more important than A. A covers my whole story. I kind of told you that beginning, middle, and end. B is just saying some kids get 5. Do we really need that? Think back to that summer that we did in class when we would do important, not important on that chart with the 3 little pigs and all that stuff we were doing right before break. We would definitely not be putting B in that column of most important or even important. We can leave that out and still get to the heart of our story and the heart of our summary. Next one says, many students have a hard time focusing when they are in school. All right, I mean, true. That is true. And that's why they started doing the study, right? Because they were going, people don't focus. They're in school. What's going on? And this guy goes, maybe it's sleep. Okay. Last one, professor teaches at Baylor University in Texas. That is definitely not important and not as important. It's a fact. Are we just looking for facts? Definitely not. And we would, as I said in that T chart that we did with important, not important, we leave that out. Him teaching and being a professor at Baylor University is not crucial to us understanding this article and also telling someone else about this article. So we are left with A and C. We need to figure out which one is most important and which one you need the most in your summary. Would it be most important if you had one sentence to tell somebody about this article? Would you tell them a professor did a sleep experiment to show students that getting enough sleep matters? Or would you say many students have a hard time focusing when they are in school? My hope is you would choose A. And why is it A? Why is A correct? It not only talks about the main character, the main idea of this, which is the professor and the students. It has both those people in it. It tells you what is going on, the sleep experiment. And it also tells you the topic of why getting enough sleep matters. It covers the who, it covers the what, and it covers the why. Down here, many students have a hard time focusing is really just this kind of small idea of they need to get to sleep, but it has nothing to do with the experiment. It doesn't talk about the professor. It doesn't go into what's going to happen or what the outcome was in any way. So we get much more information from A. So we're going to keep that in more than we're going to keep that one.
Keep up with the news and all the while avoid the blues. Kids, can anybody erase your own place in my heart? We're a strong family even though we're apart.
Imagine you opened your own restaurant. Tell the name of your restaurant. Explain what the restaurant looks like, who works there, and what you serve. I want you to really remember with these prompts that it's really what you make out of it. A one-sentence answer is not going to be what you're looking for, especially when you're tracking your growth. So you want to use these questions to really lead you and keep pushing you. So I would really kind of start with in your thinking, and in that minute, you want to think of what would it look like and get vivid with it. Think about the room. Put yourself in that room. Think of some of your favorite restaurants if you need some inspiration. And there's nothing wrong with finding inspirations from things that already exist and making them better. And this is also imagine. So you want to get creative. You don't want to say, I could never afford to do that. I could never. That's not what this fun creative writing is for. This is for you to kind of bring to life your most creative and wildest dreams. So please, please, please think outside the box, especially now when we're kind of stuck in a box, and submit, send me copies. I am loving all of the paper copies that I'm kind of getting in text messages or any kind of way your parents are getting them to me. I love it. So keep it up. It gives me the motivation to keep kind of moving in this direction. So I will see you tomorrow. And of course, Zoom tomorrow at 11, my friends. I look forward to it every single day. So see you then. Bye, guys. Miss you.